good morning, kiddos. Welcome back to the Praise Kids time for worship time. I'm so glad that you guys are sitting down. You're tuning in. I hope you guys have your sippy cup full of coffee. No, just kidding. What do you guys have in your sippy cups? Are you guys drinking orange juice, milk, water? Some of you guys trying to sip in a little bit of Coca-Cola, maybe a little Gatorade? Too early in the morning for it. I'd stick to coffee because that's what Pastor Love. Pastor Love. Who's Pastor Love? That's not me. It's Pastor Rob. That's right. All right, guys. Well, as we get started this morning, why don't we open up with prayer as we should? So what do we do for prayer? Arms up. Cool beans. Go out. Go this way. 6 feet distance, right? Okay. Clap them together. All right, guys. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come together and worship you this morning in spirit and truth. Father, thank you for every single boy and girl that is watching here this morning. God, I pray that you would just give them ears to hear, eyes to see, and a heart to be changed. We pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen. All right, guys. So I have a fun little activity that we're going to do this morning. So I want everyone to stand up. All right. So we're going to call this game In or Out. So are you in or out? So I'm going to give you a scenario, and I want you guys to jump to this way. If you're in, if this is a situation that you'd either want to be in, or jump this way, if it's the situation that you want, it's out. Okay, so in, out. Which way is this? Cool. Which way is this? Okay, cool. You guys are all paying attention. All right, so here's your first scenario. A shark is coming. Are you in the boat or out of the boat? Good, good, good. Yeah, me too. I would be like so in the boat. Would not be out of the boat for that. All right, it's summertime. Are you in school or out of school? I know. Everybody's still in school right now, right? Even though you're home. Okay. So how about this one? This happens a lot in Ohio. It's raining. Are you inside or outside? Now, if you're anything like my kids, they love to be outside because they want to find every single puddle and splash in it, right? Okay. All right. Last one. Here we go. This one's a little bit tricky. So Jesus died. Is he in the grave or out of the grave? Ah, I see. You guys are, you're thinking a little bit differently. You should think a little bit differently because it's a little tricky, right? So when he died, we know that he was buried in a tomb, right? But on the third day, what happened? He became out of the grave. So it was a little tricky question. So you guys played along really well. So that's today's story. We're going to talk about Jesus' death, burial, or resurrection because today is Easter. Very good. Happy Easter, by the way, to everybody. You guys are looking sharp in all your Easter PJs, by the way. All right, so let's go over our big picture question that we've been talking about, which is, who saves us from our sin? Very good. This is probably one of the easier questions you'll get today. Only Jesus can save us from our sin. And today, we talk about why and how he actually did that. So before we go any further, how about we get into our worship time? So everyone stand up and let's watch the worship videos and let's make sure we're singing along and participating as greatly as you guys did last week. All right, here we go.
Every one who believes in him will not perish. Beloved of the Father, you were born into this world, living in our limitations and our hurt. The promise of a healing Savior, fully God and fully man, the sacrifice for all, the spotless Lamb. The great I Am redeemed us with His outstretched hands. Jesus Messiah, firstborn of heaven, perfect salvation to redeem all men. Jesus Messiah, love's definition, willingly broken for all our sin. Jesus Messiah. You were perfect in your nature, never sinned and had no failure. Only through your blood can we be whole again. The great I Am redeemed us with His outstretched hands. Jesus Messiah.
Awesome job, guys, worshiping along. I'm so proud of you guys. The Bible tells us to worship in spirit and truth, and we are to do that every time, or else, as we learned last week, what happens? Yeah, the rocks cry out, so I don't want my rocks crying out. So I'm really glad you guys were worshiping with us. So let's talk about our Bible story today. So if you have your Bible, hold them up. Let me see them. Do a little Bible dance. Yeah, okay, cool. So I want you guys to open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 26. So it's Matthew 26. Everybody remember where Matthew is? Very good. It's the first part in the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Find Mark. You went too far. Go back to Matthew. All right. Then get to Matthew. Go almost all the way to the end. You get Matthew 26. And here's where we're going to begin talking about the story of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. So we're going to begin in 26. You guys just kind of follow along as I narrate through the story. So here we go. We jump into the story about Jesus in the gospel, where Jesus was with his disciples and he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. And this is a really important part because Jesus was on his knees and he's praying and he's pleading. And the Bible tells us that he prayed to God, "Lord, Lord, if there is any way that you could take this cup of suffering away, but not my will, but your will be done." Jesus knew what needed to be done because he knew we needed rescue from our sin. So the next thing that happens is a whole crowd full of people and Roman soldiers come up, and one of his best friends, Judas, comes up and kisses Jesus on the cheek. And that's the moment where it marks Jesus so that the crowd knows that this is the person that's going to be arrested. So Jesus gets arrested. They take him before the high priest, and they begin this like really big court proceeding where they're saying, "Who are you? What have you done? And are you the Messiah? Are you the Son of God?" And Jesus says very calmly and quietly, "Yes, you have said so." Well, then they said, "He's spoken against God. He can't say those things." So they take him before Pontius Pilate, who was the Roman governor at the time, because they're trying to get Jesus to stop spreading the good news of who he is and why he came. So he goes before Pilate, and Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He says, "You've said it." He says, "Yeah, it's true." But Pilate thinks, "I don't think there's enough here." So he takes it before the people. Now, you guys remember last Sunday, we talked about, what was last Sunday? Yeah, very good. I'm glad you guys are paying attention. It was Palm Sunday, right? The same crowd of people. And what were they shouting? Hosanna. That's right. Hosanna, which means save now. Good. You guys are all paying attention. Right. So the same crowd are waving their palm branches like, "Save us. Save now," right? "Come, Messiah. Save us." Are now the same people who are crying out before Pilate and saying, "Crucify him. Crucify him." It's amazing what can happen in 6 days, right? In five days. So now this crowd is saying, "Crucify him. Crucify him." So Pilate washes his hands and says, "All right, whatever you guys want, that's what's going to happen." So the governor's soldiers, they take him and they put this purple robe on him. And they give him a crown of thorns and they nail it into his head. And then they start to make fun of him and beat him up and trying to just really make Jesus feel horrible. But Jesus knows what he needs to do and he keeps going. It's a really important spot here. So eventually, they take Jesus and they make him carry his cross all the way to a place called Golgotha. And as he's carrying it, then they begin to nail right here into his wrist, right below his hand. They nail him to a cross and they stick him up there. And right in the midst of all this, he's seeing people all around him who are making fun of him. And he cries out to God. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now here's a fun thing. Jesus, many times when he was doing his earthly ministry here, he would often quote the Old Testament. Many times. Matter of fact, you guys remember when he was being tempted by Satan, when he responded to him, right, after the desert being, fasting for 40 days, the temptation, he quoted Deuteronomy, right, 3 different passages. Well, here, in another moment of anguish, he's crying out to God, quoting something to God the Father. I want to see if you guys can figure out what that was. I'll give you a hint. It's from the book of Psalms. So he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And he cries out in anguish one last time and dies. And there's a Roman soldier there who had been watching the whole thing kind of from the background. And the Bible tells us that he looked at all of this that had happened because as soon as Jesus dies, everything goes dark. There's a major earthquake. And this Roman soldier says, "Truly, this was the Son of God." That's an important point, because that's an important thing that you guys are going to have to decide here in a few minutes when we talk about this some more. But let's fast forward through the story. So Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea take Jesus off the cross, and they put him in a tomb, and they roll this big, huge stone in front of it. Now, the scribes and the Pharisees were really scared that something's going to happen. They were going to steal the body out. The disciples were going to steal it or whatever. So they put not only the huge stone, but 2 Roman soldiers, big, burly guys, in front of it to guard the tomb. Now, some of you guys know what happens, right? We get to the 3rd day, and there's a major earthquake that happens that just terrifies those 2 big, burly Roman soldiers, and they faint out of sheer terror. So a couple of the ladies that have been following along the disciples and following Jesus, they go to the tomb to help prepare the body. But when they go there, the stone's rolled away. They go in, the tomb's empty, and they come out, and they see an angel, and the angel says, "Do not be afraid." Now, if I saw an angel in all of the glory and splendor, I'd be pretty terrified. So it's pretty interesting. He was like, first thing he says, "Don't be afraid." He says, "The Lord, he's here. He's resurrected. He is alive." So now they're just like all sorts of confused. Like, what do we do? Where do we go? What do we do? And so they're like, "Well, we should go tell the disciples." So they turn around and go to the disciples. And who do they run into? Jesus. And again, he says, "Don't be afraid." Right? And he says, go tell the disciples, "I will catch up with them in Galilee." Now, what's so many are beautiful things that are in this story, because it's a true story, a real story of where we were lost in our sin and there was nothing we could do. We needed a perfect Savior, and that was Jesus. The moment when everything seemed the absolute worst, was a moment when God was doing the most glorifying, awesome, amazing thing that's ever happened. And I want you guys to remember that, because right now it's kind of a hard time, right? But in the midst of the hardest times, God can do the most amazing thing. And the most amazing thing that he ever did was provide a way for us to be reconciled to him, which means that we can have a relationship with him. We can be forgiven of our sins. So this is why we tell this story. This story that began all the way back in Genesis when we first fell into our sin problem has now come into fruition. And now we have a rescue plan. So what's our big picture question? Who saves us from our sin? Only Jesus can save us from our sin. All right, so we've got another big question coming from Kids Questions. So watch this video and find out what Kids Question is today.
Hey there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Ethan from West Valley City, Utah asks,
I know that Jesus died on the cross to take the punishment we deserve for our sin, but why did he rise from the dead? Why does it matter that Jesus is alive?
Ethan, that is a critical question. Thank you so much for asking that. You know, and in your question, you hit something really important, that we know how vital the cross is, that Jesus died for us. And a lot of times when we're talking about what Jesus did for us, we kind of focus on that. And it's true, it's vital. We need to understand it. But that's not all that Jesus did for us. That's not the full picture of the story that we need to understand. And so we understand that Jesus died, and that was how he paid the punishment that we deserved. That because of sin, everybody deserves to die. The question is our death going to be the one that God takes, or will he take somebody else's death, that of Christ? And so Jesus dying gives us that opportunity to have somebody else pay that punishment on our behalf. But there's more to it than that. Jesus didn't stay dead, and here's why that matters. Because Jesus, with him raising from the dead, that shows us that God the Father accepted his payment. That God looked at that death that Jesus paid and said, yeah, I'm satisfied by that. And it also shows us that Jesus defeated sin and death for us. That he didn't stay dead, so therefore we, when we trust in him, we do not stay dead as well. That we will have eternal life. We don't have to be afraid of death because we know we've been given life through Jesus. And we also know that Jesus has defeated sin, and so we don't have to continue sinning. We have the ability to say no to sin that we didn't have before. And so that's why Jesus raising from the dead is so important, not only for our hope in the gospel, but also for how we live every day. So since Jesus really did rise from the dead, how should that change how we live?
All right, I'm so glad they answered that question about why did Jesus have to rise again? So it's a really important question. I'm glad you guys were watching for that. So let's now go through our key passage because this has a lot to talk about today. Romans 10:9. So you guys say it with me. If we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Very good. We're going to talk about how you guys can participate that in a few seconds. But let's review, because we do every time. We review our questions from the story to make sure everyone's paying attention. So these are a little harder today, so I know you guys can do it. So make sure you put your thinking caps on. Here we go. First question. What did Jesus pray in the garden? Two, how did Jesus die? Three, what did the women find on the third day? All right, question four, why is it important that Jesus perfectly obeyed God? Question 5. Why is it important that Jesus really died? All right, last question. Question 6. Why is it important that Jesus rose to life? Well, the simplest way to answer those last few questions is that Jesus really needed to die because we needed a perfect sacrifice, right? So we needed him to do that. And he perfectly obeyed God, so that way he was the perfect sacrifice. He needed to be holy and unblemished. And the important part, so that got rid of our sins. But when he was resurrected, right, when he came back to life, that means we can have a relationship with God. Those are two cool, awesome, amazing things, right? There's nothing between us and God anymore when we believe in him. So this comes to the part where I want to ask you guys to be a part of this process. Some of you guys may have already trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior and been baptized. And I want to say, awesome. And now you guys have a mission to go out and rescue other people and tell them the good news. Maybe some of you have prayed, but you haven't gotten baptized yet. So we're going to talk about that. I want you to talk with your parents about getting baptized, okay? And then you guys will contact me and we'll talk about how you can be baptized. You can follow in obedience. But I know there might be some of you who haven't done either one of those things. And you want to know, how can I have Jesus as my Lord and Savior? How can I be forgiven of sins? Well, it's really easy. You have been memorizing the verse to do that. Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's as simple as doing what Jesus said all throughout his ministry, to repent and believe. You turn away, make a U-turn, and you turn towards Jesus and say, Jesus, I need you to forgive me. I can't do this anymore. And then believe. You worship God. You worship Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You say, you are my King. Whatever you want me to do, I will do. Confess and believe, right? If you do those two things, God says you're saved. So I want you to sit with your parents right now. And whatever you are, whether you need to ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, forgiveness of sins, you sit down and do that with your parents right now. Or maybe it is you need to talk about baptism. So you guys are going to take these next few moments and do that. Or maybe you've done those two things and you need to figure out, how can I go start telling other people about the amazing thing that really Easter is about? Because it's not about Easter bunnies, it's not about Easter eggs, right? Or fun, cool bow ties. We celebrate Jesus. So how will you celebrate Jesus today? By trusting him as your Lord and Savior? By making the next steps for baptism, or go telling everyone else about who Jesus is. All right, guys, there's your homework. Don't forget, I also want to keep having those pictures come in about your Bible story pics. Let's see those pics. You guys are doing a great job. Keep sending those in. All right, guys, happy Easter. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next week. Bye-bye, guys.